Two prolific champions, two distinct eras in heavyweight history. The story of the aging champion coming back to challenge the new kid on the block takes us back to the turn of the century. James J. Jeffries won the heavyweight title back in 1899. After seven successful title defenses, he retired undefeated in 1905. But 5 years later, the 35-year-old Great White Hope returned to challenge the reigning champion, Jack Johnson. Jeffries was stopped in the 15th. In 1937, Joe Louis began his 12-year reign of terror in the heavyweight division. In his prime, the Louis right hand was a lethal weapon. But in 1951, after losing a comeback title fight to Ezzard Charles, a 37-year-old Joe Louis lost to the heir apparent to the heavyweight throne, Rocky Marciano. In the 60s and 70s, the greatest, Muhammad Ali, ruled the division with a grace and a flair for the dramatic. But at the age of 38, a 31-year-old champion clipped the wings of the butterfly and took the stinger out of the bee. Larry Holmes would rule the heavyweight division for 7.5 years. And now, a 38-year-old former champion steps out of retirement and into the ring one more time. The new undisputed heavyweight champion stands menacingly in his way. At an oceanside resort in the dead of winter. Outdoor activities are at a standstill, but indoors, the action is hot. We're live at the Convention Center in Atlantic City, New Jersey, as HBO Sports presents World Championship Boxing. Undisputed heavyweight champion Mike Tyson defends his title against former champion Larry Holmes. It's scheduled for 12 rounds. It is an estimated $4 million gate, the toughest ticket Atlantic City has ever seen. The reason, it's hoped 20 years from now, people will be talking about Tyson versus Holmes, and these people can say, I was there. A 7.5-year former champion takes on the new era in the heavyweight division. As you've seen, it's a fight with a historical precedent. Now the question is, will it be a competitive fight in the ring? Hello, everybody. I'm Barry Tompkins, along with Larry Merchant and Sugar Ray Leonard. It is an evening that is wrought with questions. Can the fight itself be as big as the event? Can Larry Holmes possibly win this fight? And if he can win it, how can he win it? Many have tried, as you saw, and not one has heard that last hurrah. True enough, Jersey Joe Walcott did win the heavyweight championship at age 37, but he never stepped away from the ring. And Ray, I can't help but wonder if people aren't looking at you, Ray Leonard, particularly Larry Holmes, and saying, well, Ray did it, why can't I do it? Is that the reason he's coming back? You've talked to him on a couple of occasions, or is there another reason?
Well, Barry, let me patronize myself. I'm especially that comeback. But I was able to come back for one reason. That was to beat Marvin Hagler. No, not the money, not the attention, no the limelight. Larry Holmes, I had problems with his reason for coming back. He said that he wanted to avenge those two losses against Michael Spinks. And also, kind of, it's like a vindication to get back at what he did against Michael Spinks.
And the first question on everybody's lips here in Atlantic City, whether it's to the press or whether it's to former fighters or to just the folks around and about the casinos, is do you give Larry Holmes any chance whatsoever? The almost unanimous verdict is no. What about you? Do you give him a chance?
Well, I give Larry Holmes a chance, mainly because of his past experience. He's a very intelligent man in the ring, and he has a height and reach advantage. In other words, he has the physical attributes to compete with the Mike Tyson if he's okay upstairs. For him, the first round is vital. He has survived the first round, but also gained respect in the first round.
Well, there's another question that's been asked all week long, too, and that is, can Mike Tyson take Larry Holmes seriously as a challenger? I asked it to Mike Tyson myself, and the answer is an unequivocal yes. He takes everybody serious. Business, you see, for Mike Tyson is business. There's no alarm clock, no wake-up call. After 8 years, it's Mike Tyson's body that signals the beginning of a new day.
No one wants to get up at 4 and run when it's pitch dark. It has to be done. And the only reason I do it so early is because I believe that the other guy isn't doing it, and that it gives me a little edge. The most difficult part about fighting is the training, because believe it or not, the easy part about fighting is the fighting.
Returning to bed after his morning run, the champ awakens once again to start the day's activities. These are the members of Camp Tyson. 5 weeks prior to a fight, they gather in Atlantic City to initiate the training program. There is no entourage.
When a fight scenario takes place, we act as a family. Kevin, Mike, and I, we live together, we go out together, we go to the gym together.
Monday through Saturday, Mike Tyson goes to work. During this period, he'll train an estimated 55 hours, spar 200 rounds, and shed approximately 15 pounds. A champion's life is very monotonous.
Around a month before the fight, the only thing I think about is just training, constantly training. I enjoy it, but you know, it gets sometimes boring because it's just constantly repetitious, over and over, same thing, over and over.
From jumping rope to heavy bag, most fighters use similar training techniques. Yet Tyson's camp has developed a few tricks of its own.
Well, the purpose of the slip bag is to get the fighter moving his head, to get him in the habit of moving his head correctly. You have to try to be elusive. See, as long as the fighter's trying to be elusive, he's going to be all right. That's what I emphasize. That's what we got over everybody else.
After 7 years of slipping and dodging this sand-filled pendulum, Mike Tyson has become one of the most evasive fighters in boxing today.
There you go. That's what I'm told. That's a combination you haven't seen. When I'm on the heavy bag with Michael, I'm working on his form. I tell him, you're not moving enough, because you got to move at least 3 times. Certain punches. You throw a straight punch, you move 3 times. You throw a hook, you move twice.
Most impressive is the power and quickness he's developed. This four-punch combination seems basic. For a heavyweight, 4 punches in under a second is incredible. Watch closely.
There you go.
Besides videotaping the punches that are thrown, Mike is instructed what to throw. Each type of punch has been assigned a number.
The right hand left hook, right hand. Now give me 1-5-1. We use a number system where I call out the different numbers for the different punches, you know. 9, 10, 11. You know, body, head.
When Kevin tells me the numbers of 4, 5, 6, I know exactly what they are. I don't even have to think.
I want you to 5-1 now. 7 coming in. What's going to go 5-1?
Such a system provides a quick and private means of communication. And it's not just training. The press must also be attended to. To break up his formatted training schedule, Tyson often passes time by shopping. Still, this doesn't ease the worry or the constant anticipation of fight night.
80% of the train is all emotional. I try not to think about the fights, but usually I always think about the fight in my mind. While I'm in training, I would dream about the fight. And I always dreamed that I'd lose, and it was very scary. Like, oh my God, what am I going to do now? And it's funny, when you dream you lose, you wake up, and you wake up thinking that you lost. And it's scary.
On a good night, the group may rent a video. But on this night, they choose to screen and analyze the day's workout. And in just 9 hours, it'll be time to start all over again.
My favorite part about training is then when the train is over and then it's time to fight, and I know I'm in supreme shape and there's no one's going to beat me. Then after the fight's over and I'm victorious, you know, I say, wow, I'm going to do this next time. I'm going to even train harder.
So coming up, a former champion tries to gather up all the skills that once were there just one more time and beat a man 17 years his junior who appears, for the moment at least, to be invincible. Larry Holmes fights Mike Tyson for the undisputed heavyweight championship of the world. Now, with his own perspective on this suddenly big event, here's Larry Merchant. Larry?
Why is Larry Holmes doing this? Money? It doesn't appear that that's the case, although obviously he wouldn't be here without the money. Is he doing it for ego? Well, sure. All champions have championship-sized egos. Curiosity. What's this kid really got? I've got to test him myself. Now we're getting close. And add this. No real fighter thinks he can't do it again until he's beaten up. Not just beaten, but beaten up. So what we have tonight, in my judgment, is this. We're all here, Larry Holmes and Mike Tyson, you and us, for a ceremony. A kind of collective amnesia has set in, forgetting that Larry Holmes wasn't the Larry Holmes we remember even 2 and 3 years ago. So we could attend this ceremony, this passing of the torch ceremony, from the old king to the new king. It's a ritual as old as time. It's as natural as the life cycle of a champion, as natural as leaves turning brown and falling off trees. Of course, Larry Holmes wouldn't agree to this. Larry Holmes wouldn't agree to a lot that's been said about him in the past, and sometimes he's been very justified.
If they cheer for me, it's great, you know what I mean? But throughout my career, they always been against me because of you guys. Say what you feel, write what you feel. You feel that I'm gonna lose, write it. Don't bite your tongue about it. But when you see me win, you write it.
Larry Holmes was an underappreciated boxer whose frustrations led to no-win feuds with the press. As a former sparring partner of Muhammad Ali, Holmes first was downgraded as championship material. Even his courage was questioned. A thrilling victory over Ken Norton for the title only temporarily silenced skeptics.
This has been a great boxing show. Both fighters courageous as Holmes comes back, throws a kick.
Those people said that I couldn't be anything. It gave me the desire. They gave me the motivation. It gave me the determination to show that I can. And when I did that, I said, I showed you. I told you.
In the post-Ali era, not even a gallant comeback against killer puncher Ernie Shavers earned Holmes the respect he craved. He became a champion. Ali was a hero. And beating up the 38-year-old hero surely ended one era, but didn't start his.
Ali's my idol. If you want to say that I'm going to shadow Muhammad Ali, I'm a comic copy, great. I still admire the man. I still love the man even today. And I hate when people sit down beside me and say, man, it's a shame. I don't want to see that happen to you.
When an unproven white challenger, Jerry Cooney, got more recognition than he did before their fight, Holmes' disappointment turned to bitterness.
I felt like 2 cents fighting Jerry Cooney. I wish Jerry Cooney at the time was black, because then people would just root for the best fighter, not for the color of the skin. Don King and Dennis Rappaport, they sold racism. They never really gave me my just dues. They really didn't think I ever had the ability.
Holmes' bitterness blinded him to the recognition that he did win. And he thought that equaling Rocky Marciano's 49-0 record would win it. But Michael Spinks upset him, and the bitterness showed.
Spinks, the aggressor. A combination by Michael Spinks.
You got 3 minutes to be champion.
Well, that's got dinner.
Over here, you put your punch with him. You're going to hit it. You got to go after him. This is no tomorrow. You hear me?
Holmes will not do it. Looking for the one punch. Just about out of time. This one is over. Listen to the crowd.
You hurt me, I'm gonna hurt you back. You know what I mean? And they hurt me that night. They took away something that I worked 19 years for. Heavyweight Championship of the World.
I mean, if you really, really want to get techno about the whole thing, Rocky couldn't carry my jock strap.
I could have said things in different manner when I said Marciano couldn't carry my jock strap.
the other day, I said it to the newspaper the other day, that Mike Tyson can't carry my jockstrap. Are you going to make a big thing out of it?
Holmes had always been credited with being an intelligent fighter, but criticizing fight officials before the rematch with Spinks was anything but.
I learned that these guys get drunk when they go to judge fights.
It was a good idea for Holmes to win decisively after that. Most observers thought Holmes had pulled it out with a determined effort. Surprise, the judges didn't.
And still.
And I can say to the judges, the referees, the promoters, the kids where the sun don't shine. And since we're on HBO, that's my big black behind.
And people say, you shouldn't have said that, Larry, on national TV. Well, they did it till they kicked my behind red on national TV. Nobody said anything about that.
Now Holmes has another bad idea, insulting Mike Tyson.
I'm going down in history, not Mike Tyson. He go down in history as a SOB. If he do happen to win the fight, down the line, he's going to destroy himself.
So at 38, Larry Holmes still has the dexterity to put both feet in his mouth. The issue tonight is whether he has the dexterity to fight Mike Tyson. The issue tomorrow may very well be whether he will be remembered for the outstanding fighter he really was.
And so Larry Holmes will try to do what Jersey Joe Walcott did at age 37. Only Holmes will try to do it at age 38. A grandfather, and has there ever been one before that's fought for or won a heavyweight championship? Walcott did it against Ezra Charles. He knocked him out in 1951. But remember, Jersey Joe Walcott never stepped away from the ring as Larry Holmes has.
And he was a knockout fighter who caught his opponent with one great punch. Not likely to happen tonight.
17 years the difference between these two. Second largest age difference in a heavyweight title fight. And of course, Patterson, Floyd Patterson knocking out Archie Moore, who was then 42 years old.
At least.
Archie Moore is at Ellie Quarter saying he gives Larry Holmes a chance, wouldn't you know it?
Well, maybe that's why so much interest is generated in this fight. We've got all the gray people out there.
This fight has really brought about celebrity count here, probably as big as I've ever seen.
Well, certainly in Atlantic City. Kirk Douglas, who came to prominence doing a fight of a movie called Champion from a short story by Ernest Hemingway.
Beautiful singer, ladies and gentlemen, Ms.
And that is only part of the celebrity crowd that's on hand here. The heavyweight champions to regain the heavyweight title. Floyd Patterson, of course, knocking out Ingmar Johansson in 1960. The last one, memorable, wasn't it? Tim Witherspoon and Tony Tubbs, a dog of a fight.
If I was an editor, I would have to say I'd cross that one out. My general principle.
Hardly falls into one of the great moments in sports.
And 15 years ago tonight, George Foreman defeated Joe Frazier. Tonight, George Foreman's 40th birthday, and of course, he's trying to make a comeback.
At 40 years of age, he considers himself a bona fide contender down the road for Mike Tyson's title. Larry Holmes, incidentally, coming back saying this isn't only for the money. That question has been asked all along. He says it's not only for the money. He says it gives me the opportunity to kick back.
I wonder where Larry is. Is he having second thoughts?
Just playing a little bit of a tactical game. Speaking of playing games,
who's that?
I know that guy from somewhere. I can't place him.
And right in front of him, Michael Spinks.
So a couple of the boxing greats, I think it's fair to say. Barbara Streisand.
And Don Johnson.
It's your old tennis partner.
It's my buddy.
Played with him in Aspen not terribly long ago. And here, of course, perhaps the most familiar face, present company included, I think it's fair to say, in the sport of boxing, and Donald Trump, our host.
Ladies and gentlemen, two-time Academy Award winner here brings by Mr. Jack Nicholson.
In a sense, Larry Holmes continues to just sit it out, putting everybody, this crowd, not Mike Tyson so much, but everybody else on ice for the moment.
Yeah, in a sense, this big crowd is here as a tribute to Holmes, because The promotion itself just has gone out of sight quite unexpectedly by everybody who was close to it. They're really stunned by the response to this, and in a way it's saying, yeah, Larry Holmes was a quality athlete, a champion for 7 years. How many great-looking prospects, short-term champions there were in that time who couldn't sustain it, and this man did, and he is still, judging by this crowd and the audience we know that's out there in television land, regarded as one of the marquee names presently in boxing.
And it's, as you said, actually, really perhaps a case of amnesia, because you look at some of these figures and it really tells you just how good Larry Holmes once was.
Yeah, and here are some of the things he accomplished over a long period. He fought all the guys out there.
Another thing about him, too, is he is an underdog, interestingly enough, for the first time since 1978 when he fought Ken Norton for the title. 23 fights ago, that was the last time Larry Holmes was an underdog, and he is a big underdog tonight. Well, about this time, just in every fight, Ray Leonard, we take a look at the things that both fighters need to do to win the fight, and so why don't we do that now while we await the arrival of Larry Holmes, and let's have your tip of the night in this one.
Well, Barry, the left jab of Larry Holmes would prove to be a valuable weapon tonight against Mike Tyson. Against Ernie Sabres, his jab was so effective, Barry, and the reason I say that is because he snapped it. It was snapped the head back of his opponent. Beautiful jab, very effective jab. But while he was defending his title against Michael Spinks, his jab wasn't present. He was trying to stick his jab out, but he paused. It was not that effective. But as you can see here in the second encounter, it was a different Larry Holmes. Apparently he trained hard because he was very aggressive. He turned this into a street brawl. I doubt very seriously if he's able to do that to Mike Tyson. Now Holmes' right hand has always been criticized, but here against Michael Spinks, it was evident there was a lot of power behind it, a great deal of leverage. Here, Mike Tyson, or as I call him, Mr. Body Puncher, punched away at Biggs and did most of the damage to his body. And we should pretty much see the same scenario against Larry Holmes. Now, he must stay busy, because what happens when he's not busy, as Bunker Smith is showing us, he ties his man up. He's become very, very vulnerable to being slowed down his rhythm. His hand speed is incredible. That's what I respect about Mike Tyson. He puts his punches together very, very well. Good combination fighter.
Is Larry Holmes going to be able to rough up Mike Tyson? I think that may be the bottom line of this whole fight.
I think we may see Larry Holmes jumping right on Mike Tyson. He has to. He has to initiate some respect.
But can he do it? I mean, what they say, what everybody says, is the only way you're going to beat a fighter like Tyson is to move him back. Now, every fighter says, yeah, I'm able to do that, and we haven't seen anybody do it yet. Can Larry Holmes do it?
I don't necessarily agree just move him back. You just have to frustrate Mike Tyson and commit to mistakes and capitalize on those mistakes.
Larry Holmes is just making Mike Tyson wait. Of course, the challenger is going to come into the ring first, so Tyson's going to wait for Holmes as long as it takes. But Mike Tyson is just getting angrier and angrier. Now, you might think that that would behoove Larry Holmes, but when I asked Kevin Rooney about that just the other day, because I kind of thought he might come out, as Ray said, and really rough him up, Larry Merchant, he said, Kevin Rooney said that Mike Tyson is actually better when he's a little bit ticked off.
I just heard something. We got a report that Mike Tyson was so upset because of the stalling of Larry Holmes, he punched a hole through the wall in his dressing room. Can you believe that? Is that anger or what?
I'll have to see it.
I'm with you too, Larry.
What about the old thing that Larry Holmes has been saying, that you leave the battery on too long and the battery goes dead, he says, but you rest it and the battery recharges itself. Do you buy that? Does the battery recharge itself?
Well, Barry, what I've assumed now is the fact that Larry Holmes is trying to relive the days of yesterday, because he's playing the same song that he played years ago. Ain't no stopping us now.
Well, Larry Holmes is making his way toward the ring now, but interestingly enough, it's not the way that he was supposed to come into the ring, and it just seems that Larry Holmes is doing everything he can just to disrupt things here.
Well, I think that the guy who eventually beats the champion is somebody who has similar skills to Larry Holmes when Larry Holmes is on top of his game. Someone who can frustrate him, make him anxious, make him wild, and have the nerve and the poise to standing there while the bombs are flying all around him.
Let me ask you another thing, Ray. Richie Giacchetti, who of course is Larry Holmes' trainer and has been but for an 18-month period since the very, very early days of Larry Holmes' career, says that Mike Tyson is made to order for Larry Holmes because he's right in front of you and he has to get set to be able to punch. But Kevin Rooney says that Mike Tyson definitely has a lot of head movement and you can't just punch him.
Mike Tyson used to be in front of you, but now Kevin Rooney has some given angles. He's slipping and sliding, and all those methods of training has paid off.
Larry Holmes now in the ring.
And Mike Tyson waited about a second and a half, and he almost is running down here.
And you might notice, too, there's no music, no fanfare for Mike Tyson. Goes right along with his outfit. No robe, black trunks, no socks, black shoes, all business.
Talk about let's get it on. He didn't even want to wait that long.
Incidentally, we did have reports that there was a death threat against Mike Tyson. That's all we know. We don't know where it came from, how it was delivered, and we don't even know if Mike Tyson knows about it. Is a look at an angry young man.
Larry Holmes looks to me, he's going to fight this man the first round.
Don't get exercised here, Ray. Let's not get overexcited. And there is the record of Larry Holmes. He won 48 in a row, of course, before he lost those two fights to Michael Sphinx.
He's a businessman. He says this isn't a sport, it's a sporting business. That's the way he looks at it. And speaking of all business, Mike Tyson, 32-0 with the 28 knockouts. He fights about four times a year as champion. He is moving up in the record books, getting up there with some very, very big names in heavyweight history.
Just 21 years old and fighting his sixth heavyweight championship fight already.
And the tail of the tape, we told you about the 17-year age difference. And the weight really not any kind of a factor. Tyson a little bit lighter than he might have expected, but he was 218 the day before the fight, and Holmes a couple pounds heavier than he was in the second Sphinx fight.
Yeah, that reach difference, 10 inches, might have meant something when Larry Holmes had that great snapping jab that he could impale an opponent on. And here is our punch stat numbers. This is a device to get a statistical profile of the activity of fighters, and as you can see, the figures are roughly the same. Tyson throws a few fewer punches than Holmes did in the past, but the Holmes numbers are hard to measure because he hasn't been active. And there you see the jabs, Tyson throwing fewer, Holmes of course throwing many more.
And the rules for this one, it is a 12-round fight, incidentally. WBA and WBC now 12 rounds. Other than that, they're the rules for just about every fight you see here on HBO. No three knockdown rule, and a fighter can be saved with a bell only in the last round. Normally, that's not the rule in New Jersey, but they have changed it for this particular fight. So what's left then is to get it on. And to do that, let's go up to the ring announcer, Michael Buffer, for the pre-fight introduction.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to heavyweight history here in Convention Hall. City. Now, before the official introduction, I would like to acknowledge a man here in the ring who is indeed a man of heavyweight history. In 1960, he was an Olympic gold medal champion. In 1964, he became the heavyweight champion of the world. In 1974, he again won the heavyweight title. And in 1978, he became the only man in heavyweight history to win three world championships. Ladies and gentlemen, the former three-time heavyweight champion of the world, Muhammad Ali! Muhammad Ali! Hotel and Casino present heavyweight history. This bout is presented in association with the undisputed, undefeated king of beers, Budweiser. It is sanctioned by the New Jersey State Athletic Control Board. Boxing Commissioner Larry Hazard, Chairman Jerry Gormley, Deputy Commissioners Nick D. Balestrari and Lawrence Wallace,
representing the World Boxing Council, its president, Jose Suleiman, and ringside supervisor, Dwayne Ford. Here for the World Boxing Association, legal counsel, Satan Jabins, Esquire. The three judges doing the scoring for this contest, Rudy Ortega, Nicasio Drake, and Charlie Spina. The timekeeper is Lindsay Tucker. Counting for the knockdown seconds, Frank Cappuccino. Chief ringside physician, Dr. Frank B. Doggett. Also in attendance, Dr. Charles Wilson and Dr. Stanley Eddin. And the referee for this bout is Joe Cortez. And now, ladies and gentlemen, let's get ready to rumble! 12 rounds for the undisputed heavyweight championship of the world. Introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner. He's wearing the white trunks with red trim and weighs 225 and 3/4 pounds. From Eastern Pennsylvania, his professional record, 48 victories, only 2 defeats. 34 KOs. For 7.5 years, he ruled the division as an undefeated champion with 20 successful defenses. Tonight, he's the challenger. Ladies and gentlemen, the man known as the Eastern Assassin, former heavyweight champion of the world, Larry Holmes! Solid black trunk, weighing 215 and 3/4 pounds. From Catskill, New York, which is the hometown of the late great trainer of champions, Cut D'Amato. His professional record, a perfect 32-0, 28 KOs, 23 KOs in 4 rounds or less, and 16 knockouts in the first round. Ladies and gentlemen, I present you the undefeated, undisputed heavyweight champion of the world, Iron Mike Tyson.
All right, gentlemen, I gave you both the rules in the dressing room. Remember what I told you, I'm here to enforce my rules, obey my commands at all times. Any questions? All right, take hands, good luck to both of you.
To me, guys, the real issue here is how Larry Holmes is going to deal with this force of nature in front of him when he gets hurt. Will he just fold up? Will he fight back as he did all through his career? Or will he just hang on?
Now, I think that's really been the mystique of this fight this week, and I think that's really what's made it the event that it is. Round one. I called Larry Holmes from my home, and he said that I would not run for Mike Tyson, which implies he's ready to exchange punch for punch.
Ray, I have to ask you, any punch that anybody with an iota of tactical wisdom would go after the body and take away Larry Holmes' legs.
You agree? You know exactly, but you see what Larry Holmes is trying to do? He's trying to use that reach advantage. Keep that stiff hand out there and not let Mike Tyson get his punches on. Again, we see Mike Tyson not throwing punches inside. We see a lot of tying up from Larry Holmes, and we should see a lot of tying up.
Holmes does work the body, rather Tyson works the body early.
Again, Larry's preserving those legs. He's not doing a lot of dancing, a lot of moving, but you need to see more jabs. He's keeping his man off by extending a stiff left hand.
Holmes has contradicted himself as far as whether or not he's going to use the jab. Sometimes he says he will, other times he says, I don't need it. I'll go to the right hand and right uppercut.
Tyson's having a few problems here, not being able to measure Larry Holmes. And I think that's what Larry Holmes has in mind, to try to frustrate Mike and make him run into him.
All right, break out, break out. All right, break out. Stop punching, Mike. Stop punching. Break out to you guys. Break out to you.
We also noticed that there's not a snap. Larry Holmes is not snapping his jab, but actually, which has proven to be effective thus far, he's extending his left hand.
just holding Mike Tyson off.
All right, break out, please.
What Tyson has to do, he has to try to do a couple head fakes and work his way inside and work the body.
But once again, the popular school of thought is that Larry Holmes is going to have to back up Mike Tyson. Nobody's been able to do it yet. Left hand by Tyson. Holmes got out of there. Didn't seem to hurt him, though.
What Tyson needs to do is just pick the pace up. He drew the right hand to the body. Good idea, because, again, he's trying to slow the movement down.
All right, let it go, please. Let it go, Larry. Larry, let it go. Let's go, step back. Let's go.
Joe Cortez, the referee in this game, ironically, he was the judge who gave Larry Holmes the fight against Michael Spinks, the second Michael Spinks fight. He cannot score in this fight, however.
Tyson was trying to jump in with the left hook.
In that round, anyway, the landmark avoided the record's ball.
Larry Holmes only threw 10 punches in the first round, and not too many of them in anger.
And just to elaborate on that, by comparison, Tyrell Biggs threw 44 and Tony Tucker threw 61.
Larry Holmes being very economical in there. He's not wasting a lot of energy. He just tried to preserve that strength. Thrown with serious conviction by Larry Holmes. Didn't land, but he tried to measure. You see, once again, the timeout by Larry Holmes. Kevin Rooney probably wanted Mike to go to the body. Just stiff jab by Mike.
Strong jab. Kevin Rooney also told Mike Tyson three punch combination.
All right, break out, let go, Larry.
Remember the numbering system we talked about before the fight that Mike Tyson and Kevin Rooney used.
Larry Holmes must be careful when he tries to evade Mike Tyson, because his hands are down, and the way Mike throws those looping and powerful punches, he make it caught with one of those hooks.
Holmes so far going with a lot of right hand leads and a lot of uppercuts.
That basically is abandoning his left jab and trying to actually set up Mike with the right hand. He's trying to time Mike coming in.
All right, let him go, Larry. Break out, please.
Not letting Mike get his punches off and tie him up every opportunity he gets. There was another attempt. It fell short. The body's wide open and Tyson attacks him. I watch a good uppercut from Larry Holmes. A right uppercut.
He's tried a couple of them. Very close to a headbutt right there also.
What Larry's doing, he's throwing his jab, not with a lot of force, but he's throwing it, and he's waiting for Mike to duck down to come under with the right hand. Right uppercut.
Come on. Work the hands inside, guys. Let's go. All right, Larry, free! Larry, you're holding it, Larry. Let's go.
Joe Cortez.
talking to Larry Holmes about holding. There's a left hook by Tyson. So far, this is a fight that only the American Medical Association could love. Also, my wife, who hates violence.
Yes, she really does.
Tyson did get closer to Larry at the end of the round with that wide combination of right to the body and the left that just grazed the mouth area.
Come on, 5 seconds out.
Holmes is practicing what Archie Moore used to call escapeology. The question is, when is he going to start to practice fightology?
Both guys must be extremely careful. For Larry Holmes, he can't move away with those hands down because of the way Mike Tyson punches. For Mike Tyson, he has to be careful of not getting all anxious and coming in, winging those shots because it becomes telegraphed because of frustration.
Tyson using a long left jab, much more than we've seen him do in his last two or three fights.
See, Larry Holmes, Larry's trying to time Tyson coming in. That's the right hand.
Tyson says, no, it didn't hurt. That usually means it hurt.
Again, it only happened again there. Tyson must be extremely careful about just rushing in there.
All right, break out, clean, break out, press some points in, break out.
In the corner, Tyson complained to Kevin Rooney that Larry Holmes is holding him, and Kevin Rooney disagreed. Say, forget about that. You just go ahead and fight your fight. You see some seven jabs from Larry Holmes. There. The uppercut.
All right, wait. We got three. Let's go. Get the arms out. Get him out. Let's go.
Holmes is using every advantage that he has. The height, the long arm, and a little bit of movement.
And just waiting and trying to time Mike Tyson. And he has done it a couple of times. Hasn't hurt Tyson, but he has caught him a couple of times.
No question about it. Larry Holmes has studied the tape of Bone Crusher Smith.
There's a right hand lead by Tyson.
That fell short. Caught Larry on the shoulder.
Get on, dog. Get on, dog.
Left hand caught Holmes ducking in, but no damage.
What Tyson has to maintain is his composure. He can't get frustrated.
Break out clean. Let's go.
Holmes doing a lot of grabbing, a lot of clutching.
Again, you see what happened there.
A little bit of an elbow there from Larry Holmes.
Well, actually, Larry Holmes is just really, really trying to upset Mike and get Mike out of this fight plan. I think Mike Tyson should pick up the pace. He's fighting Larry Holmes' pace. Bell's on the counter shot that create a lot of damage.
Holmes was complaining about a low blow, and I think he was right. Joe Cortez says keep him up to Mike Tyson. That was a big right hand. Best punch of the fight. Followed up by another good punch right after the bell. Did do more fighting in that round, but he's playing a game called beat the clock. He's trying to fight about 30 seconds of each round.
Big one.
All right, Big Jack. Another one.
Let him do it. Okay.
All right. Okay. Hold on. Let's go now. Come on now.
You gotta go, sir.
It ain't over till it's over. This round had its best action right at the very end and right after the bell. Neither punch damaging.
Stay relaxed. Keep your knees bent. Your defense tight, but keep your balance. Working behind a good hard jab. When you get inside, no, you got it. Who got it?
It was Customato who said that sometimes a great old fighter who appears to be shot can pull together one big effort.
Look at Larry Holmes.
Larry Holmes is trying it right here.
Look at the jab. It's about to stick out and snap.
And the crowd is really into it. It has been from the opening bell.
Look at the jab.
Larry hands it down. He's couple jab. Watch. Look at the crowd now, Barry. It's fascinating how they change all of a sudden.
Now, I seem to hear that same kind of reaction, I think, in another fight out in Las Vegas not too many months ago.
Oh, yeah. People changed their mind because all of a sudden, Larry Holmes put up a pretty good fight.
Well, we talked about the fact that Holmes one day said he would jab and the next day said he'd use his right hand and an uppercut. He's done both.
Larry got hit by a left hook, Barry, because he stood straight up and wasn't moving and didn't have his hands up. And that's going to happen time and time again. He cannot afford to do that. Like here, for example, he must tie his man up.
That was a right hand, and down goes Holmes from a crashing right hand.
The old Larry Holmes would always get up and fire back. But he's in against a guy who is a tremendous finisher.
What?
And down he goes again from another right.
There's a full minute left in this round.
Larry trying to clear his hands while he's walking around. What he needs to do now is either tie his man up. He can't move because he's not steady. He needs to hold on.
It will take every bit of savvy that this man has. Tries to fight back. Still 40 seconds left.
He's still on clear street.
And took another big right hand. Tyson just looking for the one shot.
Well, Tyson says, be careful because
huge right hand.
That should be it.
And down goes Holmes, and that's going to be it. It's over. That's all.
Mike Tyson looked like a bull in an antique shop. And what he did was he cut down the old grandfather clock. But we did see something of the old Larry Holmes, which was his great fighting heart, something always underestimated.
He got within 8 seconds of the end of the round. His leg really buckled underneath him, too, and I wouldn't be surprised if he might not have had a little problem there as well. But I think Larry Merchant really hit it. Mike Tyson is a great finisher.
Well, I tell you, Mike Tyson did the right thing as he's done the past. He takes advantage of the opportunities, but you have to give Larry Holmes credit. Larry fought from the heart. You know, when Larry first said that, you know, he's fighting for this reason, that reason, I have problems with that. But he indicated to me in these four rounds that he was really trying to win a fight.
And he fought what you'd have to consider a smart fight, too. He seemed to do everything right for the time he was around. Here's the first knockdown now. Let's take a look at it. Big right hand right up on the top of the, over the eye.
It was a short right hand, overhand right that Mike Tyson delivered.
Watch it again. This is still the first knockdown. Set up with the left, and look at that right hand.
It was a beautiful right hand, the way it was executed, Barry, because he threw his jab, stepped inside, and delivered that overhand right. You watch the way that Mike Tyson steps in. Beautiful right hand. It was almost like a right hook.
clear the ring.
And the second knockdown equally as pretty from the eyes of Mike Tyson. This is knockdown number two now. He had Holmes off balance, a left hand there. And that was more a cumulative effect than anything else.
At this point, he was weighing Larry Holmes down. And here, Larry Holmes trying to tie up Mike Tyson, but Mike Tyson, with his incredible strength, he comes up with the right hand to the top of the head.
And Larry Holmes doing what he had always done, and that is fighting back after he was hurt.
Mike Tyson at this point here is perpetual motion. He's not giving up. He's standing right in the chest of Larry Holmes. Larry's trying his best he can because his legs are not really that stable, but he's trying to maintain. And here, this was just the amount of time here. Those shots to the body, some coming to the top of the head, but here was when Larry was really, really hurt.
That's still the second knockdown. There was still one, the third knockdown, I beg your pardon. That was the final knockdown, the third knockdown.
Larry's trying to use his arms, trying to cover up. Here at this point, referee should have stepped in, but I guess it's respect of the champion of Larry Holmes' reputation. Holmes just being pummeled at this point. That right hand did a lot of damage. Larry's legs were behind him.
Saw his left leg buckle behind him. One more look at the third and final knockdown. And the left hand was just a coup de grace, but it was definitely cumulative. I would have to say that Mike Tyson, from the first knockdown, probably hit him with 15 or 20 unanswered punches. So it's over, and let's go up to the ring announcer Michael Buffer and get the official decision.
Here's the official time. The end comes at 2 minutes 55 seconds of the fourth round. The winner, and still the undisputed, undefeated heavyweight champion of the world, Iron Mike Tyson.
Well, Ray, I'd have to say that Mike Tyson probably fought as intelligent a fight as I've seen him fight so far.
Well, for a while, he was starting to get a little frustrated and a little over-anxious, but with the instructions of Kevin Rooney, he slowed down, started going to the body more, and also what Rooney instructed him to do was to use his jab, stiff jab, then get inside. And by the later third round, it was just a matter of time.
He showed a little bit of patience, though, I think. He was using a long left jab. He wasn't just rushing in just haphazardly like he used to do when he was inexperienced.
I guarantee you, Mike Tyson learned more from Larry Holmes than he's accomplished through all this fight, because Larry Holmes, you know, is a tactician. It just wasn't his night. And Mike Tyson, without question, should be champ for a long time.
Let's take a look at the total punches in the fight, and they're pretty much indicative of how the fight went. Mike Tyson threw 132 and landed 65, just about 50%. Holmes 30 out of 70. Let's go to Larry Merchant, who is with the champion, Mike Tyson. Larry?
Okay. Okay, Mike Tyson, did this mean something special to you tonight? Because Larry Holmes was once an outstanding fighter.
Well, it's great to have the name on my record, but everyone knows Larry Holmes was a legendary fighter. And if he was at his best, I couldn't stand a chance. He's a great fighter. I admire him very much.
He made you wait for 4 or 5 or 6 minutes before the fight started. Would you just think this was the kind of gamesmanship?
Well, I was waiting for him to fight. I know when he fought.
I mean, before the fight even started, there was a long delay in the dressing room. Were you aware of it?
I didn't worry about it, because I've seen him fight so many times, and just watching him fight so many times, I was expecting everything that he's done tonight.
When you got into the fight and you saw his tactics, was there anything that surprised you, that he was just trying to frustrate you?
Well, I knew he was trying to frustrate me, but I'm too seasoned of a fighter at this stage in my life to be frustrated for those particular tactics.
A year ago, when he had an opportunity to fight you, would it have been more difficult?
Well, like I said before, at his best, he was the greatest of our time.
Came the third round, he started to drop some right hands on you. Was that really a strategy to lull you and then to hit you with some right hands?
The right hands wasn't landing cleanly. They were only glancing blows. They weren't landing cleanly.
And what was effective for you, do you feel, up until the fourth round?
The right hand. I knew I was going to have the right hand, but all through his career, All through his career, he was left with the right hand.
And eventually that proved true. Was it something you saw, or was it just a question of getting close enough, firing off enough, and
absolutely
hoping for
like
one to get it?
Kevin Roone was telling me to get close enough for I to land the right hand. And I saw it open, and I did.
When you knocked him down, did you think that he would get up?
Well, I didn't think he would get up, but he's a game fighter, like I said.
You've seen a lot of films of him. He always got up in the past. Did you think he would be able to fire back? It looked at one
well,
point.
I knew once I got him hurt, he was finished.
That you're saying that other times he was knocked down, the fighters didn't know how to finish him?
Absolutely.
Okay, now let's take a look at the last knockdown, and please describe it for us, Mike.
Well, at this point, I knew he was very hurt, and he was fighting back. So I knew to throw everything at him, but I didn't know what he does. Even though he was hurt, he was fighting back, and very dangerous. Even though he was hurt. Now you see right here, he's throwing punches, but I'm trying to land. I'm throwing everything.
Were you afraid that he was really hurt, or had you turned away and knew that it was over by that
well,
time?
I knew it was over, and I knew I didn't hit him with hard enough punches in vital areas to put him out or hurt him permanently.
What kind of feeling do you have now that you're over this hurdle?
Well, like I say, it's just another obstacle to my goal of being champion for as long as possible.
You've said in the past that the fight is the easy part. Was this the easy part tonight?
Absolutely, yes.
I said before this fight, this is a ceremony in which the torch is going to be passed from the great old king to the great new king. Do you feel in some way that's when you said earlier, it's a good name to have in my record, that's what that means?
Absolutely, yes.
The king is dead, long live the new king.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Larry.
And back to ringside.
Well, so Mike Tyson has won it in four rounds, and it's been said that if you're going to beat Mike Tyson, you got to hurt him first. Nobody's been able to do that. It's also been said that you have to back the man up, and nobody has been able to do that. There have been a couple of trainers who said Customato's fighters, of course, who use that peekaboo style, like Mike Tyson does, have to be backed up to be beaten. Nobody's been able to do that to Mike Tyson. It's happened a couple of times. Dick Tiger did it once before to Jose Torres, who was a Customato fighter, and Floyd Patterson lost the fight that he wasn't supposed to lose also to a fellow by the name of Sonny Liston, because Sonny Liston was able to back him up. But so far, Mike Tyson, of course, a bigger fighter, certainly bigger than Jose Torres, who was a light heavyweight, and much bigger than Floyd Patterson at 215 pounds, simply said, nobody has been able to force Mike Tyson to take a backward step. That was the case for Larry Holmes tonight. He did portend himself very well, actually. He came in with a good fight plan. He told many people he was going to go only right hand and uppercut. He did that. He told other people he was going to go mainly left jab. He did a little bit of that. Unfortunately for him, absolutely nothing worked. Nobody could hurt the man. Nobody could back him up. And the results in that case were inevitable. Mike Tyson knocks out Larry Holmes in four rounds. But Larry Holmes, you have to feel, will be treated kinder by history as time goes on, more so than he was as a champion. Tonight, he didn't go out with his head hanging. Sugar Ray Leonard, incidentally, is trying to make his way back to Larry Holmes' locker room to talk with the former champion. We hope to have that. Meanwhile, let's get back up to the center of the ring at Larry Merchant. Larry?
Hello again. I'm with Bill Caton, the co-manager of Mike Tyson. Bill, for Mike Tyson, he says this is not all of that special. It's nice to be the great old champion. Does it have any significance to you?
Oh, sure. It had great significance to us. Mike met the most experienced fighter he had ever met. And we felt that Mike's skills, speed, punching power would prevail, but we knew that Larry Holmes had one thing going for him, far greater experience, and it showed in the first few rounds.
This fight could have been held a year ago if Larry Holmes had been willing to take it at that time.
Yes.
And at that time, Mike Tyson was a much cruder fighter than now. Would he have had much more difficulty, you think?
I don't think so. Mike had been taught how to fight Larry Holmes by Customato. Cus would sit at the screen over Larry Holmes' fight with Mike right next to him and tell Mike how he should fight Larry Holmes. Cus had always wanted Mike to fight Larry Holmes early in his career.
Let's take a brief look ahead. What is the prospect for Mike Tyson's fights in the immediate future? The whole world knows now that he's signed a long-term contract with HBO, six more fights. What are the next few fights in your view?
The next fight is definitely scheduled for March 21st at the new Tokyo Dome in Tokyo, of course, against Tony Tubbs. Following that, there's a possibility that he'll either meet Michael Spinks, if our problems can be worked out, or else Frank Bruno at Wembley Stadium in London.
Briefly, what are the problems that have to be worked out with Michael Spinks and his promoter, manager,
In a nutshell, Butch Lewis cannot be the promoter or co-promoter of a Mike Tyson fight. That is the only problem we have. It will not be a money problem in any way.
You're saying that the champion should appoint the promoter, the challenger has to come as the challenger.
That's exactly it.
All right, thank you very much, Bill Caton. Barry?
Happy to talk to you, Larry.
Okay, thanks very much, Larry Merchant. So you have a little bit of an idea of what then is down the road for Mike Tyson. It appears that the next man will be Tony Tubbs, although the Japanese promoters of that fight have said that Tubbs must come into that fight in shape. He hasn't been in great shape lately. He's working hard in Los Angeles with Lou Ferrigno, the bodybuilder, trying to make some kind of a body out of Tony Tubbs, not to mention trying to make some kind of a fighter. He was a man at one time with a promising future, but he appears, if he can get himself in shape, he will be the next opponent then for Mike Tyson in Tokyo on March 21st. Let's go back to Larry Holmes' locker room now, where Ray Leonard is with the former champion, right?
Thanks, Larry. Larry, you displayed the heart you showed as a champion years ago. I thought the earlier rounds, your tactics were working. What game plan did you have in mind?
Exactly that. Going out there, circling time up, making miss. And what I did wrong was waiting for those fifth round, because you usually get tired around the fifth round. Waiting for that instead of going out and boxing, thinking about saving my energy. And when I started work, I wanted to go inside and I got hit, you know.
You know, you fought the big guys, big punchers, Ernie Shavers, Ken Norton. How would you rate Mike Tyson's punching power?
Well, I got to say he's a sharper puncher than the other guys. The other guys punch much harder, but he's a sharper puncher, you know. Hit me right here on the forehead and knock my equilibrium off, and that's all, you know. I just didn't have no more balance.
Did you study the tape of Bone Crusher Smith and pretty much pick up some of those tactics?
Yeah, well, you know, working around with somebody and working with the main guys and the good sparring partners, you know, pick up a lot of that. When they come in, you tie them up, simple as that. But where I made my mistake is starting to get ready to work, going to work with them inside. And, you know, he caught me with a right hook.
I think the big question is this it or?
Of course, man. This is it until someone offered me a lot of money and then I'll come out.
Are you saying that if you're offered $5 more million, you're going to
ring? We take it in consideration, but we have to look at my finances. And right now, I don't have to fight anymore, Ray. I didn't have to fight this fight, but I wanted to come back and try to prove something, try to prove a point. I didn't like the way they dumped me in. The WBC was the only organization, legitimate organization, that really stood behind me. I went with the IBF. The IBF didn't stand up. You know, everybody know I beat Spinks, and they walked away from me. And the WBA really never ranked me, period. Only one organization stood up with me, and that was the WBC. And that's why I was fighting. If I'd have won the title tonight, I would have threw the mother belts away, because it didn't really mean anything. I support the WBC, and I continue to do it now, even though I'm retired. And that's what I was trying to do. I was just trying to get back. That's something that someone took away from me, not needing the money. Everybody knows that I'm rich and I invested well. But it was something that I wanted to do. And besides, you know, I made $3 million tonight, and that's not nothing to sneeze at, you know.
But was it only the money for you?
Well, your money plays a big part. If they decided to do it free, Ray, they wouldn't have me out there tonight. I mean, let's face it, you know, for the money, I'd do it. And I got to say, you know, giving Mike Tyson credit, you know, he's better than I thought he was. At least he punched better. And he is a true champion. They can talk about Spinks all they want, but this boy is just, he's very hard to hit. He's awkward, very awkward, and punch is very good. So in my book, he's a champion. I think he should go down as such. I wish him good luck. But, you know, as we all go along, you know, somebody eventually will get us, and they got me tonight.
You know, Larry, when I decided to make that comeback, it was just for Marvin Hagler, but for you, it was different reasons, wasn't it?
Of course, Ray. You know, I didn't like the way I went out. I didn't like the way they done it to me. And, you know, I wanted to come back and show, you know. But, you know, at 38 years old, the long layoff, it kind of hurts. But I don't have nothing to be ashamed of. I'm going to hold my head high. I'm going to still love my family. And I'm going to have a party tonight. And I'm going to have a party tomorrow night. So who cares what people say about me? You know, I'm going to laugh all the way to Lafayette Trust Bank or Pillsbury National at round one. We're going to have a whole lot of fun at round one, Ray Neeson.
All right.
And Ray, you can come up too. I'll buy you a drink.
Thanks, man. I guess that says everything. Back to you, Barry.
Okay, thanks very much, Ray Leonard. Larry Merchant, we started this program by asking some of the questions. Can this be as good a fight as it is an event? Can Larry Holmes possibly win? And if he can win, how can he win? Is Mike Tyson really going to take Larry Holmes seriously? So let me ask you another question. Let me give you a hypothetical. If these two fought when Larry Holmes was at his peak, what happens?
Well, it's a thing that everybody is going to ask. The reality is that Mike Tyson would have been about 14 years old. And not to dance around it, the reality also is it's unfair to Mike Tyson because we don't know if he's reached his peak yet. We know what Larry Holmes is like at his peak. But I would say this, that Larry Holmes at his best, as we got a few little glimpses of in the early rounds, would have been all kinds of trouble for Mike Tyson at this point. He is the prototype of the kind of fighter who gives the Tyson kind of fighter all he can deal with.
Capitalize this fight for us. Good fight, bad fight, mismatch, great fight. What do you call it?
I think it was a good fight and a terrific fight for Mike Tyson, because Holmes showed early on that he still had that residue of some of the old skills. He still gave him the slow ball on the outside corner, and then he tried to shoot a quick one on the knees, and so that the perception and the illusion is that he was still in there with somebody. And then in the third round, Holmes tried to sneak a few right hands over, and actually he might have won that round. But as Larry himself said, when he moved in to try to punch with him, now Mike was within punching distance, and he beat up on him. And as I said earlier, a fighter doesn't believe he can't do it anymore until he's beaten up. And for the first time in his career, Larry Holmes was beaten up tonight.
And you know, the one thing that strikes me after listening to Larry Holmes, and it was a humble Larry Holmes, just talked with Sugar Ray Leonard, it was said about him that he conquered 48 fighters, but he never conquered himself. And I have the feeling after listening to that interview just a couple of moments ago, maybe tonight he didn't win the fight, but he conquered himself. And we'll remind you to stay tuned to HBO as immediately following tonight's telecast, you'll see on the East Coast and Central Regions First and 10, Going for Broke, and on the West Coast and mountain areas, Little Shop of Horrors. Both programs will be seen in their entirety. And be sure to tune in for HBO Sports' popular series, Inside the NFL. Join Len Dawson and Nick Bonacani, guest analyst Phil Sims, and some very special guests as we preview Super Bowl 22 from San Diego, California. And all premieres next Thursday, January 28th, right here on HBO. So for Larry Merchant and Sugar Ray Leonard, I'm Barry Tompkins saying so long from Atlantic City. The executive producer of HBO Sports and the producer of tonight's telecast is Ross Greenberg. The show was directed by Mark Payton. The feature producer was Rick Bernstein. The associate producers, Michael J. Whalen and Dave Harmon. The associate director, Steve Salvatore. Assistant to the producer, Brian McDonald. And the production manager, Russell Gavay.
Oh, you know it's a sad interrupt. I want to show you. Don't waste your energy. I'll make you an enemy. Just take a deep breath. Work your way up.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports, the network of champions.